Hi friends, I welcome you to the next lecture on INDAS41, that is agriculture. We are going to discuss about the disclosures which are required by INDAS41. Okay, so let us go ahead and learn the various disclosure requirements of INDAS41, which corresponds to IAS41, and we are talking about the disclosures relating to agricultural activity. So if you are an entity which is engaged in agricultural business, what are the disclosures required by the standard? We are going to discuss them. Okay. Now, the disclosures relating to gains or losses. The standard requires some specific disclosures relating to gains or losses. So the standard requires disclose the aggregate gain or loss arising during the current period on initial recognition of biological asset. So when you are recognizing a biological asset for the first time in your books of account, it may result in some gain for you. How much of that gain has been recognized in your books of account, that also has to be disclosed. Example, if you are doing the business of a dairy, you are maintaining a dairy farm, as soon as a calf is born, the calf has to be recognized as an asset in our books, and it results in a gain for us. Okay, so what is the total amount of gain during the year? You have to disclose that in notes to accounts. Apart from that, on initial recognition of agricultural produce at the point of harvest, the cows have given milk, you have harvested milk from the cows. So this milk is harvest for us. The raw milk has to be recognized in our books accounts as a biological asset, and it will be a gain for us. Okay. Then, from change in fair value less cost to sell of a biological asset. I'll give you an example here. You are doing a dairy farm business. At the beginning of the year, some calves were born. By the end of the year, the calves have grown into a heifer. That means the calves have grown and there is some physical change which has taken place. They have grown tall and they have grown strong and they have now become a heifer. So the fair value of a heifer is more when compared to the fair value of a calf. So this increase in the fair value is also required to be disclosed. Okay. Then an entity shall provide a description of each group of biological asset. So you have to divide the total biological assets which the entity has into various groups. How to do the grouping is also explained by the standard. Quantify description for each group. So we have to divide the entire biological asset into various groups. We may call them as mature biological assets, immature biological assets, consumable biological assets, or bearer biological assets. We have to give even the quantity also. That means the number also has to be given. Now, what is this classification? Mature, immature biological assets, consumable or bearer biological assets? Let us see in the next slide. Now, what are consumable biological assets? Consumable biological assets are those assets which are going to be harvested and sold as agricultural produce, or these are biological assets which are going to be sold as biological assets. Okay. Now, what are bearer biological assets? Bearer biological assets are not going to be sold as harvest, they are not going to be sold as agricultural produce, and they are not going to be sold as biological assets. Okay. So biological assets can bear harvest for more than 1 year, they can bear produce for more than 1 year, but whereas consumable biological assets, they are going to be harvested and sold, or it is going to be sold as a biological asset directly. Okay. I'm giving you some examples here of consumable biological assets. Livestock which is intended for production of meat. So we are rearing some livestock and we are selling them for meat. Livestock held for sale, fish in farms, crops such as maize, wheat, etc. So when you sow a crop of maize, wheat, as soon as the crop grows and once it reaches maturity, we are just going to harvest them and we are going to sell them. The crop is not going to bear you produce for more than a year. So it's going to be only one cycle. If you want again a crop of wheat, maize, you have to again do fresh planting. Okay, you have to again sow seeds. Produce on a bearer plant and trees being grown for lumber. So if you have apple trees, the apple is consumable biological asset. If you have planted trees for lumber, as soon as the trees reach the maturity age, we are going to just cut the trees and we are going to use it for our lumber requirements, or we are going to just sell them as firewood. Okay, that means they are going to give us produce only for one cycle, not repeatedly. Okay. Let us see the meaning of a bearer biological asset. Bearer biological assets are those other than consumer biological assets. Now, example livestock from which milk is produced. So if you have a herd of buffaloes, you have a dairy, you have a herd of cows, they are going to give you milk for more than a year. Fruit trees from which fruit is harvested. If you have apple trees, the apple tree is a bearer biological asset, but here I'll be very clear. Apple tree is a bearer plant. Accounting for it is done as per INDAS 16. It's a bearer biological asset, but specifically it is called as a bearer plant. Accounting is done under INDAS 16, property, plant and equipment. Okay, next. Bearer biological assets are not sold, are not agricultural produce, they are not harvested and they are not sold as agricultural produce, but they are either held for bearing produce for more than a year. So they are held to bear produce for more than a year. So these are called as bearer biological assets. Next, immature and mature biological assets. Mature biological assets are those assets which have reached the harvestable specification, which have reached the stage where it can be harvested and sold in the market as agricultural produce, or they have reached the stage where they can start sustaining harvest for more than 1 period. So if the crop has become matured, what do we mean when we say the crop has matured? It means that it is ready for harvesting and it can be sold in the market. You say an apple tree has matured, that means it is now ready for bearing fruit and it is now going to give fruit for more than one cycle. It can continuously give fruit for many years. So once the biological assets reach the stage where they can be harvested and sold as agricultural produce, or once they reach the stage where they can now sustain harvest for more than 1 period, we call them as mature biological assets. Okay. Now this distinction, consumable biological assets, bearer biological assets, mature biological assets, immature biological assets, we have to group our biological assets based on this criteria so that the users of the financial statements can estimate their cash flows very easily with the help of this information. So if you are disclosing that you have so many biological assets, you have a lot of biological assets which have reached maturity stage, or you are disclosing that you have a lot of biological assets which are consumable in nature, that means in the very near term the company is going to get a lot of cash flows by selling this consumable biological assets. So that is the importance of this classification. This will help you to estimate your cash flows in a very easy manner. Okay. Next, and we should also disclose some other information. What is that information? If there is any restriction on your title relating to a biological asset, or if you have pledged your biological assets as a security for loans taken, that information has to be disclosed as in the notes to accounts. The amount of commitments for development, acquisition of biological assets. If you have entered into any commitment to buy biological assets or to develop biological assets, then such commitments have to be disclosed. Financial risk management strategies related to agriculture activity. So what are the financial risk management strategies you have, we can say, developed for meeting the risk in your agricultural business. Next, you have to give the reconciliation of opening and closing carrying amounts. So what was the opening carrying amount of the biological asset, closing carrying amount of the biological asset, you have to give reconciliation. And the reconciliation will be done by the gain or loss arising from changes in fair value less cost to sell. So if the fair value of the asset increases, definitely the closing balance of the biological asset will not be equal to the opening balance. Increases due to purchases. So how much purchase you have done during the year. Decreases attributable to sales or biological assets classified as held for sale. Decreases due to harvest. So when you harvest produce from a biological asset, the carrying amount of the asset is going to reduce. So we have to give these items as reconciliation of the opening and the closing balance of the biological assets. Next, increases resulting from business combinations. You have taken over a company which is also involved in the agricultural business. Their biological assets will become your biological assets. Automatically the account balance will increase. Net exchange differences. Suppose you have a foreign subsidiary, it is having some biological assets. You have to convert those biological assets into your reporting currency and report them. So there will be some exchange differences which will arise. Or your functional currency is dollar, that means you are maintaining your books of accounts in dollars, but your presentation currency is INR. In such cases, the assets which are shown in your books at dollars have to be now converted into INR for the purpose of reporting. Again, some exchange differences can arise. That will cause the difference between the opening balance and the closing balance. That has to be disclosed. Then any other changes which are going to explain the difference between the opening balance and the closing balance of the carrying amount. Next, exceptional items. Now, an agriculture activity is often exposed to climatic diseases and other natural risk. So they can sometimes arise certain losses because of these risk. Entity would have to disclose those losses. If they are material in nature, they would have to apply the requirements of INDAS41, that is presentation of financial statements, in disclosing these items. Okay, they might have to be disclosed as exceptional items. Example, sometimes events have like outbreak of a virulent disease, a flood, severe drought, frost, or a plague of insects. These can cause some losses to your entity, and these are exceptional in nature. You have to understand the requirements of INDAS41, and you have to apply the requirements of INDAS41 in disclosing these losses in your financial statements. Okay, that means there can be some exceptional losses as well. How to disclose them is prescribed under INDAS41. Okay. Now, disclosures relating to assets carried at cost less depreciation less impairment. In our earlier lectures, we discussed a very important issue. We said biological asset at the time of initial recognition has to be measured at fair value less cost to sell. But at initial recognition, this assumption is rebuttable. Normally, the assumption is biological assets can be measured at fair value less cost to sell. But this assumption can be rebutted only at the time of initial recognition. That means at the time of initial recognition, you are not able to estimate the fair value of the asset reliably. Market prices are not available, or other methods of estimating fair value are not reliable. In such cases, when we are not able to measure the fair value reliably, the standard permits you to use the cost model of accounting. That means such biological assets can be recorded in your books of account at cost, and in future they will be disclosed at cost less accumulated depreciation and accumulated impairment losses. So what are the disclosures relating to such assets which are being now disclosed using the cost model, not using the fair value model as per INDAS41. So we have to disclose certain things: a description of such biological assets to which we are applying the cost model, an explanation why fair value cannot be measured reliably. You have to explain the fact that there is an inactive market, other methods of estimating fair value are not reliable. You have to disclose those reasons, and if it is possible to, you have to estimate the range in which the fair value of such assets may lie, okay, if it is possible. The depreciation methods used for depreciating such assets, the useful lives, depreciation rates used, the gross carrying amount at the beginning of the year, less accumulated depreciation and accumulated impairment loss at the beginning of the year, gross carrying amount, less accumulated depreciation, accumulated impairment loss at the end of the year. So you have to give a reconciliation between the opening WDV and the closing WDV, okay. Then impairment losses, reversals of impairment losses, depreciation, profit or loss on disposal. Okay, so we have to give these disclosures with respect to assets, biological assets, which are not measured at fair value less cost to sell, but which are measured using the cost model. Okay. Next, if fair value becomes subsequently measurable, there can be a situation where initially you are not able to measure the fair value of the biological asset, you recorded it at cost. But subsequently, we are able to estimate the fair value of the asset. Market has become active, or with the help of other methods, we are able to measure the fair value reliably. In such cases, we have to give some disclosures: a description of the biological assets for which we are now able to measure the fair value reliably, an explanation of why fair value has now become reliably measurable, the effect of the change. So how it has impacted our accounts for this year, you have to explain that effect as well. Next, disclosures relating to government grants. See, we discussed in our earlier lectures that entity engaged in agriculture activity may sometimes be entitled to get some government grants. Government grant not to carry out a particular type of agricultural activity, or government grants received to compulsorily carry out agriculture activity in a specific location for a specific period of time. So in such cases, we have to recognize, account for those government grants as per the requirements of this standard, not as per the requirements of INDAS 20. Okay, but certain disclosures are required: nature and extent of government grants. What is the purpose for which you have received the government grant? What was the amount? So you have to disclose that fact. Okay, recognized in the financial statements. Then unfulfilled conditions. If there are any terms and conditions which are imposed by the government which you have not fulfilled, those conditions have to disclose. If there are any contingencies relating to this government grant, then those contingencies also have to be disclosed. Significant decrease is expected in the level of government grants. That means this year you have received some government grants, but in future you don't expect to receive those government grants. That means you expect to receive lower levels of government grant. That fact also has to be disclosed in notes to account.